We had created in the lecture a class which would represent the time that a piece of code takes, so a timer class. Okay, so here is a more elaborate version of the class. So let's go through the code just to understand what this elaborate version is doing. So first of all, if you remember, code can throw exceptions, right? So what we are going to do is make this kind of this timer sort of a little bit proof against misuse by saying that you must stop it only after you start it and so on. Okay, so we will have a new error that we are creating, and this is just a way of creating a new error. So we say that timer error is a new class which is of type exception. It inherits from exception. Okay, so just so these quotes inside these double triple quotes, these are what are called documentation strings. So they are the things that you get when you hover over a function. So let me see if we can see that. Let me just execute this, and then if I go and for instance, if I sometimes if I hover over something, I might see it. So it's loading something, but anyway, we'll come back to that. But anyway, so the main thing is now we have this timer error exception. So when we start the timer, instead of setting it to 0, we will put the start time and elapsed time to none to say that it's not set. So now when you start the timer, it must be a timer which is not running. So that's the difference now, that we can check that this timer is not running by saying is the start none or not. If the start time is not none, it means the timer is already running. So we can raise an error saying timer is running, please use stop, right? So don't restart the timer because it's already running. This is a mistake. Otherwise, if there is no error, if you don't raise, so this word raise is basically to create an exception, right? So if you don't raise an exception, you do what we had seen in the slide, which is you set the start time to the current value of performance counter. Remember, the current value of performance counter has no independent meaning. It is just used as a reference to subtract later. Similarly, when you stop the timer, you check whether the timer is running. So if the timer is start time is none, it means the timer was not running, and you give an error saying timer is not running, please use start. Okay. Otherwise, you set the elapsed time to the current value of the performance counter minus the start time, and you reset the start time to none. So now the timer can be run again because you have stopped it, but you have saved the time in elapsed time. So you can look up the elapsed time, but the timer is not running and it's ready to run again. Okay. And finally, elapsed, as we said, we'll check that actually that the elapsed time is something meaningful, right? It's not the first time when you never set it. So if the elapsed time is not none, it will give you the elapsed time, otherwise it will throw an error. Okay. And finally, we have, if you just want to dump the value of the timer, then you get the elapsed time, right? So that is the string function. So now this is the piece of code that I wanted to show you. So this is just a trivial piece of code. It's just a loop which is running this n equal to n plus I for I ranging from 1 to some large number. Okay. So what is that large number? I'm doing it for 10 to the power j, where j ranges from 4 to 9. So I'm doing it for 10 to the power 4, which is 1 with 4 zeros. That is 10,000, 100,000, that is 10 to the power 5, 1 lakh, 10 to the power 6, and 10 to the power 7. Right, and then 10 to the power 8, because 4 to 9 will be 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So it's running it for each of these values. And what are we doing? Before we start the loop, we are running the starting the timer. And when we finish the loop, we are stopping the timer. Okay. So this is just a simple loop to tell us how long Python takes to execute something as trivial as n equal to n plus I that many times. Right? So if you run this, right, then you can see that the first time, the time when it takes 10,000, it runs in 0.01. It's probably difficult to see on the screen, but I will share this code with you and you can run it. When it's, you can trust me to say when j equal to 4, the output of the timer is 0.01001. That is 1/1000th of a second. When it is 10 to the power 5, it is 0.01. It's 1/100th of a second. When it is 10 to the power 6, it is 0.13. It's about 0.1 seconds. When it's 10 to the power 7, and this is what I promised you in the lecture, that 10 to the power 7 operations per second, it takes 1.3 seconds. And 10 to the power 8, it takes 13 seconds. So you can see that there is a clear 10 factor speed up or slow down rather when I increase the number of operations by a factor of 10. So when I go from 1000 to 10,000, from 10,000 to 1 lakh, from 1 lakh to 10 lakhs, from 10 lakhs to 1 crore. Each time, this loop takes 10 times as much. And it's useful to calibrate now our expectations when we run code. We will see later on that when we are trying to, for instance, if you're trying to sort a list or you're trying to do some other complicated operation on a large structure, then you might actually end up taking some 10 to the power, some number of steps, as we will see. And it will be useful to estimate how long it's going to take without actually running the code. Right? We have a kind of a clear idea that if it's going to be, if I have to traverse a list, for example, whose size is 10 to the power 7, it's going to take me 1 second just to go from this end to that end. If it's 10 to the power 8, it's going to be 10 seconds just to go from this end to that end without even doing anything. Right? So we will come back to this later on, but it's useful to have this kind of timer to give us an idea about how long things actually take when they run, because we can do a theoretical calculation, but there is nothing like seeing it in kind of black and white to know exactly how long your code is taking.